Welcome to my presentation on nutrient capture and complementarity in intercropping systems. My name is Alice Hofland and I'm from Wageningen University, the soil biology group. What does complementarity mean? In the Oxford Dictionary, it says that it is a relationship in which two or more different things improve or emphasize each other's qualities. For intercropping, it would refer to interactions that lead to increased resource use efficiency through resource partitioning. And the key mechanism underlying complementarity is niche differentiation. The simplest form of niche differentiation is perhaps spatial niche differentiation, and this certainly happens in intercropping systems. In this slide, you see on the left the root length densities of fava bean and on the right of maize growing together in an intercropping system. The roots of fava bean on the left are distributed horizontally in a shallow, limited zone under the plants, whereas the roots of maize on the right side spread under that of fava bean. So the maize plants can exploit a soil volume that is much bigger compared to when they would grow in a monoculture, and this will lead to increased nutrient capture by maize and thus by increased nutrient capture of the intercropping system. Another example of niche differentiation is temporal niche differentiation, which means that the two plant species in an intercropping system don't grow in the same period of time and only partly overlap, and in the periods where they grow alone, so outside the co-growth stage, they don't have any competitors for nutrient uptake. So in these three different situations with different temporal niche differentiations, here on the top one they grow together all the time and no temporal niche differentiation. But in the bottom example, there's very little overlap. And so there's most of the growing period, species 1 doesn't have to compete for nutrients with species 2 and the other way around. And you can imagine that this also leads to enhanced nutrient capture in intercropping systems. So how does temporal niche differentiation relate to increased nutrient capture? The nutrients are simply captured in different periods of time. That means less competition for slowly released nutrients. For instance, decomposing organic matter can be used over a longer period of time, but also the roots of the first species decompose and can provide species number 2, the second species, with nutrients. This is a very under-investigated mechanism, but I'm quite sure that this contributes a lot to complementarity in nutrient capture in intercropping systems, particularly because the benefit of intercropping systems increases with temporal niche differentiation. And this is probably one of the reasons for that correlation. Perhaps a more interesting kind of niche differentiation is referred to as the resource partitioning hypothesis, and that can be explained by these diagrams. On the left you see two plant species, species 1 and 2, who have access to only one and the same resource of nutrients, for instance, and that leads to competition for this resource. On the right hand side you can see what complementarity means. Each species has access to its own unique nutrient resource, which relaxes competition, or there's no competition at all, and instead there is complementarity, which can lead to increased nutrient capture. The most investigated example of resource partitioning is that of intercropping with a cereal and a legume on the right hand side. On the left hand side, you see the situation where if you would grow two cereal species, they both tap from the same soil mineral N pool for their nitrogen capture. But if you grow a cereal together with a legume, then the legume can use its own unique nitrogen source, atmospheric N2, and the cereal can further exploit a soil mineral N pool. This is a very often investigated combination, and you've heard a lot about this. This field experiment is a demonstration of this idea. In this experiment were legumes combined with barley, and on the first red bar you see the nitrogen accumulation of one of the legumes, a pea, and which fixed 72% of the nitrogen was originating from nitrogen fixation. And the barley, the middle red bar, took up way less nitrogen, and the average of the two is below, is less than what the combination, the third red bar, accumulated. So this combination of pea and barley accumulated more nitrogen than one would expect based on the average of the two monocrops. And also the percentage of nitrogen originating from fixation increased. It was 72% for the pea grown in monoculture, but now it is 87% when the pea is grown together with barley. And that is because the barley was present as a competitor and exploited, took up more nitrogen from the soil, and which stimulated the pea plants to increase the nitrogen fixation from the atmosphere. There are many examples of this type of complementarity. Now, this is a kind of meta-analysis on 13 papers by a Danish research group, where on average the cereals accumulated 84 kilograms of nitrogen per hectare from the soil or from fertilizer N. And the legumes, when growing in a monoculture, took up 67% kilogram nitrogen per hectare from the soil or fertilizer, and in addition 126 kilogram nitrogen per hectare through nitrogen fixation. So the average of these two would be 138 kilograms per hectare, but when they are growing together, the average nitrogen accumulation was 150 kilograms per hectare. So here is the complementarity effect. An additional 12 kilograms of nitrogen was accumulated by the intercrop. These were all experiments where no or little nitrogen fertilizer was added, maximally 50 kilogram. So one may wonder whether this intercropping complementarity effect is reduced at high nitrogen fertilization rates. This indeed is the case, although not significantly. This is the effect on yield in megagram ton per hectare of 660 studies in relation to nitrogen fertilizer input, and these are all intercropping systems, including a legume. And according to the stress gradient hypothesis, these facilitative competitive interactions would dominate under unfavorable conditions, so under low nitrogen availability, whereas under high nitrogen, favorable conditions, competitive interactions should dominate. Well, indeed, there is a slight negative trend of the intercropping effect, the benefit with nitrogen fertilizer input. So the slope is negative, but the p-value is 0.1. So there is not a very strong effect of nitrogen fertilizer input on these benefits. And that is because most of the legumes are combined with maize, and the overyielding of maize is explaining most of the intercropping effect. So the resource partitioning effect of combining a legume with a non-legume is context dependent, and its impact may not be as big as one would hope for. Here is an Another example of nitrogen uptake by mixtures, in this case cover crop mixtures, and on the left hand side you see the uptake over three growing seasons by the monocultures, vetch, which is a legume, oat and radish, and on the right hand side you see the nitrogen in the cover crop in the mixtures, the total in the mixtures. And in this case the vetch radish, vetch plus radish, does best. It is not even higher than the average based on the monocultures, but it is absolutely higher, the nitrogen in the cover crop of this mixture. And this is not so much because vetch is facilitating radish, but vetch is a very poor competitor, which leaves radish a lot more space. So if you analyze where the benefit comes from, then it is mainly again from the radish. Similar to the previous example where the maize was predominantly responsible for the intercropping benefit. And so again an example that the benefit of combining legumes is contextual and not always necessary because of a huge complementarity effect through nitrogen partitioning. The rest of this presentation will be about phosphorus. We wondered whether this idea of resource partitioning would also apply to P. And the research done by Chunyi Li was inspired by a paper in Plant Physiology by Philip Insinger and others with the inspiring title P42, Sharing a Scarce Resource. And this paper suggests that resource partitioning does exist for phosphorus, because plants are able to mobilize different P resources, and a soil is always a mixture of different P resources. Now, how would that work? Well, phosphorus comes in various species. For instance, there's organic phosphorus, and so P from organic matter, which can be used by plant species that produce phosphatases. That they hydrolyze the organic P and make phosphate available. Phosphate comes also in precipitates with calcium in high pH soils, and they can be dissolved by plant species who acidify their rhizosphere with organic acids, or complexate calcium, for instance, through binding with citrate. And a third form of phosphorus is phosphorus adsorbed to metal hydroxides, typical in low P soils. And this phosphate can be released through competitive adsorption with citrate. So citrate occupies the same adsorption sites and releases phosphate from these sites. This slide shows how this could potentially work. Here we have pots with two different pea sources, the blue pea, for instance organic pea, and the yellow pea, for instance calcium phosphate. And on the left you see species 1 that is very well able to mobilize, for instance, the organic blue pea. And since there are 6 units in this mixture in the pot, each plant can take up 3 units of organic pea. And in the middle you see, for instance, chickpea that perhaps can use the yellow pea source very well, which means that each plant can also take up 3 units of pea from this yellow pea. And on the right hand side you see that the mixture of these two species, the blue and the yellow, should be able to mobilize 6 each, which would double, in this theoretical example, the pea capture through complementarity in this intercropping system, in this mixture of two plant species. We wanted to know whether this could also work in reality, so we checked the capacity of several plant species to use different pea sources. And here you see the example of chickpea on top and millet on bottom. And you see 5 pea sources, or actually 4. The first one, 0P, is a quartz sand where no phosphate is added. And you can see that the chickpea is still able to grow quite well because of a large seed stock whereas the millet can hardly grow. And on the right-hand side, you see the 100% soluble potassium phosphate as a reference. And in the middle, you see the three sparingly soluble phosphorus sources, calcium phosphate, organic P, phytate P, and iron hydroxide bound P. And we compared the capacity of these species to grow on these three sources. And on the right-hand side, the length of the bar shows the capacity of millet and chickpea to grow on these P species. And you can see that millet can grow quite well on the blue, the calcium phosphate, whereas chickpea can grow quite well on the green, the organic phosphate source. So this could mean that if you grow chickpea and millet together on a mixture of phytate P, organic P and calcium P, that they would mobilize more P compared to when they grow in monoculture or on one P source only. We tested this in a pot experiment where we grew the combination of chickpea and millet on either calcium phosphate alone on the left or organic phytate phosphate alone or on the mixture. You can already see something happening in this pot experiment. The millet grows very well and the chickpea remains quite poor. And this could mean that the competition between millet and chickpea is very unbalanced. In the graph you see the results. The blue bar, the blue part of the stack bar is the P uptake from the calcium P and by the two species together, and the green part of the bar of the stack bar, left stack bar, is the P uptake from phytate P by the two species. And if they now complement each other, then you would expect an increased P uptake from the mixture of the two P sources. And indeed, we saw this happening. So this is a confirmation of the P partitioning hypothesis. This was a pot experiment with two species. We did that for several species, and we did that for several combinations of phosphorus species. And we found that the hypothesis was that dissimilar traits, so complementary traits to mobilize phosphorus, would lead to complementarity. And this, as I have shown, was conferred for the combination of millet chickpea on calcium and phytate P. But it was not confirmed, it was rejected for cabbage and fava bean growing on iron and phytate P. The flip side of this hypothesis that it would be that if plants have similar traits to mobilize P, so they mobilize the same kind species of phosphorus, you would expect no complementarity. And this hypothesis was rejected for maize wheat on calcium phytate P, and it was confirmed for maize wheat on iron phytate P. So very confusing results and mixed evidence at best for this resource partitioning hypothesis. The previous experiment, the pot experiment, was done on quartz sand mixed with different species of pea. But in soils, you always have the two species together and you cannot separate different pea sources. So here we did, we repeated this experiment on a real soil. And this is again the example of millet and chickpea. And the soil were two different soils. The soil number two had more pea than soil number one, but both had a mixture of calcium phosphate and phytate pea, organic pea. So similar to the quartz experiment. And again, here the pea uptake is shown by the two species, millet and chickpea. And in this graph, we compare the uptake by the monocultures, the left bars, with the P uptake in the mixtures, the right bars. And in none of the two soils, the mixtures took up significantly more P than expected based on their soil cultures. So in the real soil, we did not see this advantage of intercropping that we saw in the quartz sand experiment. We think there are some complicating factors that could potentially explain the absence of the intercropping benefit in the previous slide on the real soil, and some dissimilarities with the nitrogen case. First, there's overlapping P acquisition traits. It's not like species 1 has unique access to P source 1 and species 2 has unique access to P source 2. You have seen in the first experiment with the pots that both millet and chickpea can use more than one P species resource. So there's overlapping P acquisition traits. And it's not like nitrogen, where the legume has a unique access to N2 that the cereal does not have. Second, all species take up P as phosphate, so that in the end they all tap from the same pool in the soil solution. It's a bit related to the first bullet. It means that if plant species mobilize calcium P or phytate P, they actually make it available as phosphate, and that can also be taken up by the other species. And we think that happens in the chickpea-millet combination, where the millet grows very well and grows fast, whereas the chickpea remains small. And it could be that the chickpea that mobilizes phytate P that is in the end taken up by the roots of millet because of competitive inequality. Yes? So maybe this idea of resource partitioning only works if the species have the same or similar competitive ability. That is actually the fourth bullet. Yes? So the competitive inequality also disturbs this resource partitioning idea. And then the third, there is plasticity in P acquisition traits, and that is similar to nitrogen fixation. We have seen that the P increases its percentage of nitrogen accumulated through nitrogen fixation when it is combined with barley, and also the root exudates responsible for mobilizing sparingly soluble P sources, their concentrations change depending on whether the plant species grows in monoculture or in a mixture. Finally, we tested this combination of chickpea and millet also in the field in China. We means Chunyi Li, PhD student who graduated recently on this work. And she performed a field experiment over 2 years where she compared the mixture with the monocultures and analyzed their root exudates and, of course, the pea uptake and the yields of the different systems. And here are some of the results. On the left hand side, the yield, and on the right panel, the pea content. She checked the rhizosphere concentrations of phosphatase, and indeed chickpea had the highest concentration of phosphatase, but millet had the highest concentration of carboxylates. And so this confirms that chickpea is very well able to mobilize organic phytate P, and millet should be able to dissolve the calcium-bound P. So the conditions for resource partitioning were there. If you look at the yields, these are the results of 1 year. She did this for 2 years, and in this year, you can see that she used two different P levels, P0 and P100, and P100 is quite a huge amount of phosphorus. And you would expect, based on the stress gradient hypothesis, that these beneficial interactions, the complementarity for P resource use, would be most important or prevalent at low P conditions. But she saw the highest yield at the P100 treatment. And so this is a rejection. This means a rejection of the stress gradient hypothesis. And if we look at the peak content on the right hand side, the x-axis titles are the same. And here you see that the peak content increased in the mixture at the P0 treatment. So this would mean, okay, a confirmation of the stress gradient hypothesis, but it didn't result in overyielding. In the left panel, you can see that at the P0 treatment, there is no significant overyielding. Whereas at the P100 level, it was exactly the other way around. So increased yield, but no increased P uptake. So we concluded that complementarity in P capture does not drive overyielding. So what are the conclusions of this work? First, partitioning of nitrogen resources can drive overyielding, but its effect is certainly context dependent. It is reduced at high P level, and there can also be issues of unequal competitive ability between, for instance, the radish and the vetch. So it needs a balance in competitive strength. The P42 is a highly attractive concept. It is much referred to in literature, but there's little proof for it. We tried to prove it, but we found no indications for complementarity in P capture, certainly not in the field, only in the quartz sand experiment in a very artificial system. So perhaps other mechanisms for overyielding and intercropping are more important, particularly temporal niche differentiation, which may also be related to nutrient capture, but certainly is also related to increased light capture, as you have probably heard from other speakers before. Thank you very much for your many thanks are due to Chunyi Li, who has presented during this workshop as well, and she did most, if not all, of the work on millet and chickpea and many other species.